The largest of roads will be coming right through, and tenants affected are feeling most blue. With banging and clanking, the tenants have found, the noise and vibration can be felt underground. The dust, fumes and dirt with an ear-splitting din are part of the environment we tenants live in. Each day of the week and hour of each day, the blight of our lives without any say.
Below the clean clinical images of Canary Wharf Tower lies the mess of Europe's biggest building site.
Solicitors acting for council tenants in Docklands have begun a multi-million pound compensation claim against developers and the London Docklands Development Corporation. They claim up to 10,000 people living in the shadow of Canary Wharf have suffered continual disturbance from building work. Some are said to have had breathing problems from dust levels.
We've got the roads on one side and we've got the DOR coming through. We've got the dust, the fumes. It's affecting all our lives. Most of us are stressed and we've got overcrowding. Just living in this area is just a daily nightmare.
One of the big jobs we've had to do is to try and improve the transport in and out of the area. And parts of it, as you know, are still under construction and causing disruption while they're being constructed. But the purpose is to get the economy working in the area and make it possible for people here to have good jobs in the future for themselves and their children.
We thought by the Docklands moving into this area that we would be given a better chance of life. But in fact, the opposite has happened.
About 3 years ago, plans began to emerge for this new motorway. And of course, people have had to move out of their places to make room for this roadway. And it's people who didn't want to move out of the area. They're quite happy where they were, but of course, they had no option. We've got to move you out, and that's all they say, you're going.
They have absolutely destroyed our community. Hitler started it because these blocks were put up during the war. And they just avoided being bombed. And the LDDC has bombed our estate. They have devastated our estate. Our estate has absolutely been shattered.
It's had a huge impact in the sense that so many people have been moved out of here. Communities have just been, I could say, raped.
The effects have been very bad for many people. Old people, for instance, who've lived in their apartment for decades, suffered very badly from having to move to a new area that they didn't know, among people that they didn't know. It broke up the community. One lady came to see me, she had multiple sclerosis. She was able to live independently because her very good neighbours in the block of flats she was in helped her. She was very scared about what was going to happen when she had to move to an entirely new complex.
Since my mum's moved, they give her a place in Devon's Road. The LDDC thought, oh, these are lovely houses, but they don't realise that these are people's roots,
yeah.
And roots are important.
Yeah. Well,
since my mum's gone over there, my mum had a heart attack, and it's just the strain and stress of moving.
I would have much preferred to have stopped where I was.
But unfortunately, the road was too near. They pulled it down.
Your state itself was nice, wasn't it?
Yeah, so the state was nice.
But the road and the whole surrounding area was so gross and polluted, and it was horrible to live in it. But the estate itself was nicer, much nicer.
There's no doubt that some people have wished that they weren't the people in the line of this new road and that they didn't have to move. But in terms of improving families' housing conditions, it has been a major success.
Elizabeth Filkin will say to anyone, oh, people love it, but she don't know the amount of illnesses and nervous breakdowns that are going on over all their decanting and breaking up a community. I mean, that part of it she doesn't want to see. I mean, she then rises above everyone in the ivory tower and shuts herself away. And it's people in the community who've got to pick them pieces up again, which is hard and upsetting.
Actually, I consider us to be quite lucky.
that we were able to come away from what is going on there now.
It's really
because those poor people that are living on them estates now are going through hell.
Yeah, we're still better off.
At least we got away from it. They never.
What this is doing to people who live and work here, young children, older people. The number of children who've got asthma is absolutely phenomenal.
I live in the main East Sydney Dock Road and I suffer with asthma and bronchitis, and over the last couple of years it's increased. I'm at the hospital much more frequently and I have to use 4 inhalers 8 times a day.
In the summer last year, I mean, Canary Wharf used every possible hour, and then long summer's night, they really persecuted us with, and there were layers of dust in the atmosphere. But the people say, oh, you're safe. But I put my daughter's uniform away when they finished for their summer term, and I washed that, and I laid it away in plastic bags. And when I took that out in September, to wash it, to freshen it again, for her to go on to autumn term, it frightened me. There was grit and dust that came out of that clothing. So then the people won't tell me that that's not penetrating our homes and penetrating us. I mean, if anyone would like to take a school shirt of my daughter's and do a test on it with another neighbouring borough and one of the suburbs, I'm sure that would tell all the stories.
I work in the nursery and the young children, they come in all eye problems, all chest problems. Sometimes they can hardly breathe. Even the teachers have to take time off. The teachers have all got asthma pumps. They come from all out of London, whatever. They come and work here and they can't believe the conditions that we have to live in. But see, people that come on these Dockland trains and all other in their cars, they don't realise because they can just go home into their own environment. They can forget about it, but we can't.
No, we can't.
We've got to live day to day here, and it's a nightmare, and I wouldn't wish it on anyone to live here.
As far as I'm concerned, we've seen all the people from the council and the people from the LDDC about doing something about the health problems here, but nobody seems to worry or want to worry.
We've attempted to control the activities of the contractors by monitoring their noise and their hours of work and that sort of thing. But, I mean, I would say that I think it's been probably worse for them even than people expected. We have actually taken 2 contractors to court because they failed to meet the terms of the agreement.
We have double the national average, and in fact we have over 20% of children currently with asthma. This is colossal workload for us, and it's a colossal level of suffering for people in the community around here. And having worked in this practice since the beginning of the 80s, when Docklands development was a much more minor affair, I'm very well aware of an increase in the level of asthma.
I've told you we can't get BBC One or BBC Two.
I mean, it's a complete fiasco. If the developers had been forced to actually state what they were going to build in the first place, rather than being given carte blanche to do anything they wanted by the government, then the BBC would have been informed that Canary Wharf was going to be so big that it would cast a shadow across the whole of the area, a shadow in terms of TV reception.
In the finish, we ended up owning cable TV. I mean, that's £18 a month. I was all right while I was at work, but now I've retired, I just can't afford £18 out of my money a month.
It's just one more way in which people have had their quality of life affected, their lives have deteriorated because of the developments.
problem is what it is, they've built this for the rich. They're not thinking about people but us.
Progress, but not for us. For us it's not progress, because it is upsetting everybody.
As soon as you open your mouth, you say, oh, you can't do that because the LDDC doesn't approve of it.
Over the years, I have been to so many meetings and seen so much injustice about this sort of thing that I've got to the stage where I want to get something done because I'm so frustrated with the rest of it.
On the left-hand side, they've decanted a lot of people and they've absolutely split the community in half.
As we see the development progressing, it came that we weren't going to be of any involvement in their plans at all.
Our two blocks were left out of the accord. Initially, it was Jonathan Matthews who was responsible then. And I approached him on numerous occasions, and Vivian told me then that it was hard cheese that we were left out of the accord.
He was your local councillor?
Yes.
The accord is an agreement between ourselves and the London Borough of Tower Hamlets about how we construct the road, about who needs to be rehoused, about what other things need to be done to the homes of people who live near the highway.
I think what people have to remember and bear in mind is there are a lot of very powerful people behind the road and the other developments. Obviously not just the LDDC, but also the multinational developers on Canary Wharf. And also they had very strong backing from the government. So we had to avoid just lying down in front of the bulldozers and getting steamrolled, where we'd have got really nothing out of that, the minimum compensation.
They've really used St. Vincent Estate. They've used the whole of this corridor. Our people's been made guinea pigs because we're suffering the effects of noise, dirt and dust. And, you know, when they've taken off half the people, given them nice homes with fridges, washing machine, homes that were built for yuppies in Timber Wharf, which they couldn't sell, they've negotiated with the council to house people down there and wherever people wanted to go. But they decided to leave two blocks standing here, sticking out, you know, isolated. So yeah, we regard ourselves as guinea pigs because we're suffering the effects of the noise, the dirt, the dust.
They were faced with the really serious problem of the LDDC coming in and smashing apart their community, really, by demolishing this estate, St. Vincent's estate, most of this estate, and parts of other estates. And they were finding it really difficult to make the LDDC or the council listen. It was the five tenants associations on the five estates working separately and individually. And they were each campaigning in their own right, if you like, but separately they weren't having that much effect, that much impact on the LDDC and the council. And so we had the idea of forming an umbrella group involving all the tenants associations working together in a joint campaign, and that resulted in Splash.
We're in Splash, actually called Splash, and we're in it because of the road links, and the house has been pulled down, people been put to different estates, shunted here and there, people that didn't even want to move, leave their homes. And we decided to join to fight because actually we was getting nothing off with nobody, no help, and we decided to form the group
together so that we could all fight together as a bigger body.
And after numerous letters and contacting by phone and trying to make meetings in a civilised manner, we had to take ourselves as an organisation splash and almost bulldoze ourselves into the boardroom of the LDDC, which we found with, you know, most upsetting that we had to be acknowledged in this manner.
We went to the Isle of Dogs here back along, we all picketed, we went three times we've been to these meetings trying to get in to see what's going on. The first time we went there, we went to the meetings, was a gang of us, all the mothers and like the people that live here.
Kids.
When we got there, yeah, we took the children with us. When they got there, they got the security guards out to throw us off,
off the property
mate. But we actually got into the building, we stood there and said we wanted to be in on this meeting and we wanted to know what's going on with these plates. They're trying to hide us from like mousies. They don't want other people finding out what we're up to, you know. They want to keep us trapped in one room. They don't want us to make noise, you know. But we made noises and we're about to make more.
So whom do we talk to with faith and with trust? To the LDDC, for talk to them we must. We don't trust them either for reasons the same. They started so badly, and much to their shame. They promised the earth, we accepted their pact. We should have known better. Their words were an act. The LDDC say they are giving us more money for different things. We've asked for more community centres for children, and also for the grown-ups, somewhere to go. But instead of that, they're taking things away from us.
When the kids are at school, we've got an hour or so to free time, you know, have a cup of tea and chat with the, you know, everybody in the block. So where are we going to get together? We've got no place at all. We did have the club over there for, like, children and everybody to go and play, or if they got free time to do all sorts of things. Well, the club is now no longer exists. Well, they demolished it, didn't they? And they've got these big drums of the, I don't know what they're doing over there.
Yeah, well, we complained about all the workmen going backwards and forwards, and they come along and put the fence up, and now they've took away the little bit of playing space that was left, you know, for the kids. But considering he's the only one left here anyway, I mean, he's got no one to play with. All the kids have been moved out, you know, so all his friends have moved, because they all lived in the square here. In general, it's just, you open your window and all you do is you look out to this fence here. And there's nothing more, you know, for him to do here anymore. Is there?
The playground around is one of our demands, that something be done to enlarge it, to make the facilities better, because we've got something like 200 children on this estate. They're mostly small children. There are two swings for them to play on, a small little bit of tarmac, and basically nothing else.
We had a community hall downstairs, but it said on the site said that the LDDC worked with the local community. Then all of a sudden it's become a private day nursery. Therefore the children on our estate have nowhere to go. Most of us, we haven't got highly paid jobs, so we can't afford the money to even put our child in the day nursery.
And we set up our own project to have Dolphin House returned to the community in place of all that's been taken from the community, returned as a community centre. There are no facilities along this along Poplar High Street. There's hardly anything for local kids. There's no swimming area. Poplar Baths have been taken by the LDDC for a construction training course.
2 years ago, the Will Crooks tenants, who live very near to Dolphin House, approached the London Borough of Tower Hamlets and ourselves about their view that it was needed to improve the sports and recreation facilities in their area. And I think everybody was in agreement that it would be very beneficial if this could be done. They were particularly keen to see a swimming pool and other community facilities provided on one of those sites near to their estate. The Social Accord Forum, which is the body, that's the joint body between London Borough of Tower Hamlets and the LDDC, considered this proposal and agreed to allocate £30,000 to work to be done to investigate what it was that local people needed and what was actually feasible on that particular site. Because, of course, almost any of the proposals that come out of it not only require a facility to be built, but they require the facility to be run thereafter. And the LDDC, of course, doesn't have funds for ongoing funds to run a local facility.
They set up a study group. They put aside money to pay a group to do a feasibility study on the possibility of using Dolphin House for a community centre. We've heard nothing. The results were made known, but no money, because basically the LDDC doesn't have the will to put money aside for the community. That's the gist of the problem.
My surgery is full of people with the most terrible family problems, the terrible health problems created by the lack of housing in the area. We have 11,000 people on waiting lists, people living in blocks of flats where they're trapped because they can't get their wheelchairs down the stairs, people living in unhealthy conditions who cannot move because there are no places for them to be transferred to.
Well, my daughter's been waiting 4 years with it. She's got a young son at four. She was 12 when she was a year old. She'd get a two-bedroom maisonette and a two-bedroom flat, and she's still waiting.
The main problem in St. Vincent Estate is overcrowding. We wanted major knock-through so that we could enlarge the units, make them into bigger and more comfortable.
We've got cockroaches. The ants will come up through the front of the building here, plus in the back. No, if you get up in the morning, if you've got sugar or anything out in the kitchen, or everything's got to be covered with seals, because you get up in the morning, everything's just covered in ants. Christmas time, they got their little calendars with chocolate in it. This year, they was plastered. I had to throw it, they was hanging on the wall. I had to throw them away because the ants was climbing up the wall to get to the chocolate.
People at first didn't take the tenant seriously because in the past it's been quite easy to divide and conquer, which seems to me to have been the tactics of the LDDC. But the longer the campaign has gone on and the longer they've realised that we're a consolidated group and that we're not going to give in on our demands, the more respect we've actually been given. To the extent that when we ask for meetings with the LDDC board or with the borough, we actually get them now and they come to us.
I think if the LDDC had had its way, we wouldn't still be here. We would have been cowed by now, made to feel even more powerless and helpless, and more importantly, shut up.
As a group, they can actually plan together for the kind of improvements that they want for the area in the medium and longer term, and that by being united and an independent organisation for themselves, they don't have to be pushed around and told what to do by the LDDC or indeed the council or anybody else.
I got involved with the splash when they asked me to start developing an economic plan for the area. What they told me in the beginning was that we have campaigned on a whole range of issues, especially to do with environment, but we want to move away from there. It might seem to a lot of people that a splash is Luddite. They are not. What they are saying is we need to move into a phase where we ourselves begin to develop projects, begin to develop ideas about economic regeneration in the area. Splash is saying is we want to work in a spirit of partnership. We want to sort of say, yes, the private sector can come in. We want to say Europe can come in, provided they recognize that the biggest investment that they can make is investment in the community.
I've seen what they've done on the island, the Isle of Dogs, where they've, what money can do over there. And we don't want the same problem on this side of the island. This side, we want a community that is mixed, one with decent housing, decent recreation area, decent community centres. Our children are our future. They're the future of Docklands. And what we're asking for is decent human life.
Some of our old people from our community have passed on, so we can't ever make up to them for what their last months have been. But hopefully we can do something about the elderly and the housebound who still live in this area, who have a right to this area, who worked through the war, who fought through the war to preserve this area. You know, they're the unsung heroes, and it's an awful stigma on our society. It's a terrible indictment of our society that this is how we deal with our elderly.
In that complex, they're bringing in all their materials for that building by barge. And I bet if we walk around this borough now in Docklands, you won't find one man that was dismissed as a lighterman who could get a job back on that river. Our construction rug, they took our swimming baths away. They're training our youth to build, be bricklayers. And if you go and see there, if there's one complex down there that's took a bricklayer, it'll be hard to find. So they've had our youth on, they're having us on, and they're going to have the youth to come. And now we're going to say, it's all stopping now. Because we have got a commitment to our community, our LP and our community, ourselves and our youngsters, and that's what it's all about.
We're trying to film here today. We've come here, we're trying to show people the disruption it's doing to the community. And as we're filming, they're trying to lock us out here. This is the way that they treat the community. Can you open the doors, please? We're just trying to make a video.
Would you tell me who gave you the instruction to close the door?
Will you give me the instruction to do a video this time?
Can you repeat the door? We're just trying to show what's going on here.
Oh, they don't want you to see what's happening, do they? That's the point. They don't want you to see how near to the houses that they are. You know, they create a terrible din, but nobody worries about it, you see. I even attended the meeting of contractors. Considerate contractors, they call themselves. That's something to put on the record, isn't it?